played Dota 2 for thousands of hours, but you've always wanted something more. A reason to fight, a deeper meaning to your battles. But to know the hidden history of Dota 2, you must go on an adventure of a lifetime. An adventure into the lore!
Oh, it's that time again. Another battle pass and so many taunts, items, and voice lines, but we all know what we really came here for. The one time a year where they finally add some new lore to go with all these cosmetics. Now, as you know, not all the lore is created equal. On one hand, you have the new arcanas, some with over 800 new voice lines. And on the others, you have this. Call it what you will, it sure looks fun. Yep.
Yep.
Anyway, there's a lot to unpack here. Immortals with some lore, taunts, but the real prize is, of course, arcanas. Why? Voice lines. Especially unused voice lines accidentally left in the files. And whoo boy, do we have some secret voice lines for you this time that give away way too much about upcoming heroes. We will hit that up at the end, but for now, arcanas. No, not the Wraith King arcana. That one just says that he was Skeleton King. Well, okay, it also adds to his lore that he likes cats. And he has a sundial, which Templar stole to give the Void Spirit. And he was also the one responsible for giving Slark the job that got him locked up in Dark Reef Prison. But whatever. It's not enough for its own episode of LOREGASM, so we will get to him later. We here for the real shit today. Hello. Oh my god, is that a new lore comic? Ooh, baby. Goodness gracious, a lore comic. It has been ages. Now, for some reason, you can't even access this bad boy in the game, which is weird. I guess Valve was worried if people had to read, they might have less time to spend money, but whatever. I'm not complaining. There's a freaking lore comic. So yes, as you may have noticed from the title of this video, today we will deep dive into the lore of the new Queen of Pain, or QWOP, Arcana. Now, before we get started, let's get one thing out of the way. This is LOREGASM. Now, a QWOP is a sensitive subject for some of you viewers, and you might be expecting some traditional gasm content in this episode. I ain't about that shit. If you're looking for sexy pics or you get a sub-dom fix, let me tell you, there's plenty of sites on the internet for that. We care about the real important stuff here. Lore implications. So set sail, simps of the world, and embark on a journey with us into the lore! Now, surprisingly, we have a lot to talk about here in the background department. The majority of the lore here actually needs some knowledge about the Dota 2 universe in general, which is fascinating because most of it is from artifacts. Please don't shut off the video. And it's trying to connect the lore between Artifact, Underlords, and mainstream Dota 2. It's a little understandable if you get lost in the lore here because you might have a life, unlike me. So don't instantly recognize every little thing in the lore. Well, that's fine. That's what I'm here for. All right. As always, first up, the general Arcana description. Content for so long exploring the playground of the mortal realm, Akasha returns now to the dangerous court of Ristul, where her star has fallen in her time away. But the queen above intends to claim as well the throne below. Striking a bargain with an exiled demon prince, Akasha has seized a new measure of power, and her fiendish plans are at last set to begin. Alright, a lot to take in there, but we'll get there. Short and sweet is, QWOP is half demon now. That's about it. So let's start off with the model itself. We're bringing this up first because there's not really that much to explore on this. Quap is transfused with the power of an exiled demon prince, so she's all demony. We got fire, we got pointy ouchies. The only real big addition is a new demonic tail. Also, apparently the only way you could get a nose job in the Dota 2 universe is to make a deal with a demon, so that's cool, I guess. If you unlock the second style, you also get to play as Vengeful Spirit, which is cool. Okay, and that's really about it. Jokes aside though, the second style actually makes her look like her original model's color a lot more, which to me makes it seem like she's more in control post-demonic conversion and looking more like her original self rather than the demon taking over. Well, that's probably reading too much into it. All the arcanas seem to have a Toucan Sam setting now, unless of course you're Skeleton King, then you're just terrifying. Moving on, let's check out the trailer. Now what we're really gonna focus on here is the background. This is, I believe, the first look we have had of Hell, or the Seven Hells, in the Dota 2 universe. This is a pretty big deal, because a lot of heroes are connected to the Seven Hells and other nearby regions. And this being our first glance, we indeed have a lot to see. First up, check out the structure behind the throne. The gaping maws on this cone-like structure is very reminiscent to this Lich set, which is probably a coincidence, but since Lich steals mana, aka some part of your soul, it's a stretch, but it's interesting that it's there. Anyway, in the back, we can see what appears to be a city, or at least ruins, decorated tops of buildings, interconnected bridges, but when you go into the game and you see the intro, these assets are much more clear and appear to simply be rocky outcroppings. Now, there's a chance that we might have a Demon City capital in the background there, but who's to say? What really interests me here, however, are the clouds. After we get pushed back, we see these amazing face animations, we get a much better view of these clouds, and it's pretty fascinating. Okay, so Hell in Dota is literally under the ground of the Earth, and there are seven levels to it. What we see here, though, are clouds, and what appears to be light shining through those clouds, along with those crazy-ass tentacles. This raises a ton of questions and adds more to the debate if Hell is a realm or a biome. AKA, is it an afterlife or a physical place that just so happens to be where souls of the dead go, like Florida? It's confusing, but to me it seems like these tentacles are breaching through, not coming from the clouds, which makes me think that there is earth above those clouds, putting Hell as a physical biome. Perhaps right under the abyssal plane, but again, we'll get into that. So visuals aside, let's get to the real meat, the comic. This is gonna take a while. This comic is basically a massive lore dump. So get comfortable, we're going line by line. It was the eve of the narrow maze, and Akasha couldn't have been more miserable. Normally, the spectacles of souls fighting for their freedom brought the demoness joy, but today her mind dwelled on her legacy. That's very interesting. Now, the narrow maze has been presented to us before as a place. When you die, you must navigate the maze and it will determine where your soul goes. If you try to escape, you get hunted by Visage. If you try to hide or stop moving, you get violently motivated by Razor's electric whip. In the past, we were presented with the narrow maze as a sort of pearly gates with Saint Peter. It was this realm of judgment in Dota 2. Now, it appears to be something quite different. The eve of the narrow maze makes it sound like it's a time, a event. My mind instantly went to demons and angels cheering in a stadium watching the souls run below, which is pretty weird. Is the narrow maze a realm? Is it an event? Or is it both? A place that only souls get dumped into during a full moon or something? Who's to say? But what's even more interesting is the line, fighting for their freedom. Now, the whole point of the maze is to reach the end. So to me, specifically using the word freedom rather than exit or destination makes me think that it actually does literally mean souls can fight to return to the living world instead of completing the maze. I mean, we have a lot of examples of this already happening. Monkey King apparently did it, according to Alexa in his comic, and Lion has done this, according to Visage. But the real linchpin here is from Artifact. Check out the lore for the card Cheating Death.
The Narrow Maze is a nightmarish labyrinth where the souls of dead heroes are given a chance to return to the living. Axe claims he's escaped it twice, but I don't believe him. He would punch death in the face before he could be taken to the Narrow Maze.
So yeah, the Narrow Maze is a place, but it appears that its purpose has been kind of retconned. In Visage lore, it is said that all creatures die and choose to travel beyond must someday pass beneath them. For an untethered spirit, the decision to journey through the Veil of Death is irrevocable. By craft or by cunning, some restless soul escapes their hells or heavens. AKA, the maze was a choice that spirits could make to pass on to their heaven or hell. Interestingly enough, this is one of the few, if only, references to a heaven in the Dota 2 universe. As all Dota players know, there's a lot more hell than heaven in the world of ranked matchmaking. Anyway, Razor's lore calls the Narrow Maze a treacherous webwork of passages which souls of the dead are sorted according to their own innate intelligence, cunning, and persistence, which of course is strength, intelligence, and agility. And it allows for souls to decide their own fates, hurrying toward a luminous exit or a endlessly dark pit. Now, does this mean that there was no heaven? The luminous exit was simply going back to life? Or did it mean that this has been changed completely? Well, we don't really know. I mean, in general, Razor's lore is all sorts of confusing. His oldest enemy is Storm Spirit, for some reason? I mean, why? The lightning? Also, when you die, Razor puts your name down in the Book of the Dead. If you erase your name, apparently, you can't die anymore, as Monkey King may have done. But the Book of the Dead is literally in the game now. It's a 60-minute item. And when you use it, four level 3 Necronomicon units spawn, which, according to Underlord's lore, Necro units are actually demons. The one with the shield known as the Brill Bruiser. So why, when you read Razor's Book of the Dead, four demons pop out? Oh, guess what? It's also an artifact, but when you use it there, zombies come out. Furthermore, Crystal Maiden convinced the world that Winter Wyvern should be the keeper of the Book of the Dead. I have no idea. If you think that shit's confusing, Razor hails from the Underscape, which is a region apparently after the maze, which you would think is a blanket term for anything in the afterlife, but no, there's seven hells and apparently heaven, so it's a unique place. Post-maze, pre-hell, pre-heaven, the Underscape. Maybe it's purgatory, I don't know. Okay, it's time to break out the Microsoft Paint. Welcome to Slax's map of the underworld. We're gonna be referencing this just too often in this video. So here we have the world's crust, aka the Tyrian Plain, aka the surface. You die and you go to the Narrow Maze, which may or may not be optional somehow. And if you make it through, you go to the Underscape, which is somehow the route to heavens or hells. And below that, you have the seven hells separated by impassable membranes. Heaven? Is there a heaven? Apparently Visage lore says that they can escape it, but I don't know. Anyway, yeah, that's how it is. So back on track. That's how it was. Is it like that now? Maybe? The eve of the Narrow Maze, again, could simply be the specific time the souls go through to populate the maze, or it could be simply a time where some souls can choose to try to escape. I'm gonna choose to believe this because if the maze just manifests itself on its one eve or something, my brain is going to explode. So perhaps this is the event, the eve, that allows souls who are escaping to go back to life and fight. Why would you call this event the Eve is beyond me, but for my headcanon, let's just make that the case so we don't entirely retcon what the narrow maze does. Okay, that was half of page one. Let's move on to the other half. On the mortal plane, she was known as the Queen of Pain, but to the court of Ristul, she was merely a sister of Bakor. Court of Ristul, Quap has a brother. Oh god. Okay, the Court of Ristul. Now, we have a lot of theories on this in our demons video, so check that out if you haven't seen it, but let's try to sum that one up short and sweet. Bring up the Microsoft Paint. So there are seven hells, each hell potentially a different kind of realm that does different things to keep hell functioning as a society. Think Dante's Inferno, but if every level of hell, they were all working together to create the kind of SimCity state. Now, from what we know, there are lords of hell. I assume the lords of hell were kind of the bosses of each of their own levels. We honestly don't know anything about these hells. The best evidence for this we have is the demon witch Clint slayed, Maraxiform, was the big boss of 6th hell. So there you go. We have these seven providences, let's call them, and one creature to rule over them all. This would be Doom. Why? Because you can't travel to different parts of hell, at least not easily, unless you're Doom. Doom has a sword, which he can cut through the membranes separating hells. Now, why is it called a membrane, by the way? Is hell a body? Are these cell membranes? Was hell inside you the whole time? Probably not. But since Doom can freely go through each level, it makes sense that he would kind of be the de facto leader. He's a big badass ex-angel, and he's the only guy who can go anywhere he wants. So, you naturally make him the king of hell. But having one king make all the decisions for hell is a great way to have an uprising. Okay, these are demons, after all. They tend to have a problem with authority. So comes the Court of Ristul. Now, as always, we have very little information, but check out the description for the Ristul emblem and artifact.
To those willing to step into a world of demonic etiquette and politics, the Court of Ristul is willing to offer considerable power for a price.
So from what we can tell, Ristul is a demon court of governance. You have all these basically separated providences of hell layers. Each one has their own representation in court. The court makes the calls for all of demonkind and generally organizes their society. In fact, the court might directly oversee the narrow maze itself. Check out Razor's responses in Underlords.
The Court of Ristul is happy to help. May their souls languish in the Court of Ristul. I hope the court was watching. So, you seek aid from the Court of Ristul.
Now, I believe that one of the biggest jobs of the Court of Ristul, the demon parliament, if you will, is overseeing the relationship between the human, aka the living, world. You see, demons need souls, for reasons, Shadow Fiend especially, and hell is populated by the souls of the dead. Now, demons are very strong natural predators. If they really wanted to, I bet they could wipe out the surface completely. But again, that would wipe themselves out. It has always been my headcanon theory that the court was created as a way for demons to be a bit eco-friendly. Demons keep relationships with the living world to have as much influence as possible, but not so much that they destroy their most important natural resources, human souls, or too little that the living decide to do some kind of purge hell crusade led by Omni Knight. Keep the balance. However, it would appear that the court also has much to do in the underworlds as well. It's sort of a aristocratic governing agency. And Quap's brother, Bakor, is quickly rising in its political hierarchy. Page 2. Bakor and his allies, Nevermore and Vergros, continue to amass power. Okay, sure. Shadow Fiend, that makes complete sense. He's been pretty much the face of the Court of Ristul so far. Check out the description for the oath in Artifact.
I knew why you're here. Despite all your intentions and ambitions, things didn't go as planned and you need help. Help that the Court of Ristul is willing to provide. But before we lend you our strength, there's something we need you to do.
And check out Underlords.
Only I am fit to sit on the Court of Ristul.
So we've kind of known him as the de facto Court of Ristul leader, if not a very high-ranking member already. But now we have this. Underlord. Oh boy. You see, Underlord hails from the Abyssal Plains. Specifically, it's described as an underground obsidian city named Aziog. It is a sprawling underground honeycomb of subterranean caverns and houses the Abyssal Horde, a huge army which Underlord is the leader of. He uses his special power, the Dark Rift, to move his gigantic army to the surface, where they lay waste and capture slaves to toil in his city below. All good, but is he a demon? Yes, I guess? I mean, he has had these demonic symbols on his abyssal blade before, but if he is on the Court of Ristul, a demon court, then officially he must finally be classified as a demon, right? Well, luckily, we have an answer to this very nerdy lore question.
In my eyes, you're not even a real demon. Decree or no decree?
So, it looks like Bakor, Quap's brother, sent a royal decree claiming that Underlord is now to be officially treated as a demon, most likely to gain his favor and become his ally. Which is fine, this all makes sense, except for this line. They gain clout on the Abyssal Plain. Bring up the drawing! So we know that the Abyssal Plain is literally under volcanoes. It says so in the lore. It says right there. Yet it makes the sound as if it's a bigger term. Why would you need to build clout on a plane of existence? You already have the leader of the leaders is Underlord. So maybe the Abyssal Plain is not simply an area. It's actually a plane of existence for everything in the abyss, aka the underground, or God forbid it is actually another entire biome, another one. Look, we have 14 planes already, and that's like not even including things like the underscape, the void, the land between the walls, the nether reaches. How many planes of existence do you need before you are satisfied? The Turian plane, the astral plane, the primordial plane, the fundamental plane, the elemental plane, the prison plane, Spectre's mysterious mystery shadow plane, and now perhaps the abyssal plane? Please stop with the planes, okay? Apparently, we have another one. Underlord doesn't just come from an underground city that he called the Abyssal Plain. It is apparently an entire society slash biome called the Abyssal Plain. And are the nether reaches in there? A system of underground caves and caverns that Viper and Pugna draw power from? Or is it in a different place? What about Avernus, where it literally means underworld and the mist rises out of that place, it flows to the surface and it's connected to demons. Is that on the Abyssal Plane? Or is that its own plane? Why are there so many things underground in this universe? I don't know. Whatever. What's important is the great lore nerd debate is over. Underlord is officially now a demon and is involved with, if not an active member on, the Court of Ristul. So, let's talk about the new guy in town. Bakor. Queen of Pain's a brother. How does a demon have a brother? Does she have a mother and a father? I have so many questions. The first one being, didn't we already see the King of Pain 3 years ago and it was created by Max? Demon physiology and family structure aside, Quap now has a brother, and he is gaining power and influence in Hell. And Quap hates her brother, for some reason. Moving on to the next page, we travel to Weeping Rose. Oh, so much to take in here. Weeping Rose is a city in the world of Dota. It's basically Hogwarts on crack. If you love practicing magic and want to learn or practice the most dangerous and insane new magic an insane wizard can conceive with your neighbors, well, you move to Weeping Rose. I think the emissary of the Quorum says it best.
The more judgmental call Weeping Rose a place where magic is unfettered by morality. A chaotic city of delights and horrors. And they would be partially right. The city was founded on the idea that good magic and evil magic are labels created by lesser minds. But there is no chaos in Weeping Rose. The Quorum ensures that is the case. And it is on their behalf that I have traveled here.
And while we're here, check this out.
Most of the magical world acknowledges the authority of the Sapphire Conclave. But in Weeping Rose, we govern ourselves, answering only to the Quorum, a senate of 31 powerful wizards. And while Weeping Rose is not home to many rules, the few we have are obeyed without question. Because failure to do so is to be sent to the Tyler Estate.
That was read by Vanessa, by the way. Remember her? So, little breakdown here. Weeping Rose is a city of wizards. The Sapphire Conclave is basically the Avengers of magic users. It's a collection of very powerful magic users who have representatives in each one of Dota 2's regions within the world, and they're usually there to just protect people. The Quorum are the leaders of Weeping Rose, who write and enforce the very few rules of the city. And if you break those rules, like Lion, who is being hunted by Anti-Mage and Silencer, you will be brought to the Tyler Estate, who drag naughty wizards kicking and screaming to their home base to torture them and probably strip them of their magical powers. Look, we have an Anti-Mage persona coming out, and I'm sure that is going to be insane with Tyler Estate lore, so let's get back on track. Here we are, in Weeping Rose. Lots to take in from the background. Top left, we see buildings that look very similar to the artifact card Stars Align, which is super cool. Listen to this.
Weeping Rose is shrouded in perpetual nightfall, a means for the Quorum to harness the power of the stars.
And in the center, we see a magic user who seems to be practicing the same kind of buffing magic the emissary of the Quorum uses in Artifact. To the left, it looks like salves and clarities are being sold, which is pretty neat. And to the bottom right, we see some magical swords and I think the buckler? Now, Weeping Rose might sound nice, but it's got a seedy underbelly. Now, it ain't as bad as White Spire, the city that Underlords takes place in, but stuff like buying magic creatures as slaves seems to actually be a thing there.
I heard a rumor of some gorgons being moved through Weeping Rose.
In fact, on the top right, we can see a little caged wisp, much like Dark Willow's friend Jex, lighting up the street. Shout out to Ravishing Parsnip for seeing that one on stream, by the way. I almost missed it. So yeah, Weeping Rose is a pretty crazy place. So let's move on to the next section. She wasn't there for the Quorum, not looking to go to the Burnt Hall where dangerous and cursed artifacts like the Apios' Blade are stored, or to barter with a djinn and the evil genie. This is interesting, we've heard of the Djinn of Khaldeen before, a djinn that gave life to sand to form Sand King, but we never knew there was more than one. And finally, we're introduced to another new character, Knock, the exiled prince. Yep, you might recognize this one. This is from the leak. Long ago, there was an untitled fantasy game Valve was working on, and one of the artists leaked some art he did for it. This was several years ago, but strangely, many of the names started popping up in the Dota 2 universe. Mazzy became a full-fledged artifact hero, Jalexia became the card fawn, aka the literal main character of Artifact, and Lacelle and Vanessa are two big players as well. And look at that, there's Knock! Spoiler alert, I'm sure the other three are gonna show up as well. So before we can get to them, let's talk old Quap lore. Now, demons have rules. They are confined to hell, for the most part. Demons can't willingly leave hell. Only three seem to have that ability. We guessed this is what makes them demon lords. Obviously, Doom can leave. You can play him in Dota, and he already has unprecedented hell travel abilities. You have Shadow Fiend, which goes to the living world to collect souls for his mysterious master, which may be the one who allows him to have this power. And you have the Shadow Demon, who was summoned to the Turian plane as a servant, but ended up mind-controlling people and became a cult leader. The only way other demons can get to the surface is to basically be kidnapped, to be summoned there by a powerful wizard or a dude like Warlock making some chaotic offerings. Now, this is not a rare occurrence, and usually it's short-lived, as with Warlock's ult. But if a powerful summoner can work their magic right, they might enslave a demon forever. This was the case with Quap, as she was summoned by a perverted BDSM-loving king. She couldn't kill him, but she could bring him so much of his horny pain that he became obsessed and ignored his kingdom. Eventually, his subjects led an uprising where people threw him out a window. With the man she was enslaved to dead, she became free. Now, we always assumed that she was kind of trapped on the living world, but she was really enjoying it. That, however, now appears to not be the case. I mean, if she's watching the narrow maze, as shown on page 1, she seems to just be able to go back whenever, which is weird, because Anessex, a underlord, not the underlord, claims to be a earthbound demon as well. And we could assume that's the same kind of thing happened to her. Now, she claims that she is a earthbound demon, which strangely makes me think that she is bound to the earth, but apparently not. Anessex appears to be sort of a liaison between the Court of Ristul and the Turian Plane, using her influence to spread theirs. But she also has some problems popping up, possibly caused by Pakor.
It was bad enough dealing with Enno, Jewel, and Hobgun, but now Nevermore is trying to oust me from the Court of Ristul. This is a situation I need to deal with personally.
Anyway, all this aside, on the next page we learn that Kanak will suffer the same fate as Quap and possibly Anessex, but he has it even worse. He got summoned by someone that wasn't an idiot. Ladies and gentlemen of Dota 2, please welcome Vanessa. You see, Vanessa is a huge character in the Dota 2 Extended Universe. She's kind of a mix of Iron Man and John Constantine for comic nerds. She's an extremely powerful wizard, powerful enough to be invited into the Sapphire Conclave, but she's rebellious. She does her own thing, which makes her a prominent figure in Weeping Rose. From playing a part in saving our reality from being ripped apart by Time Lords like Faceless Void, to being the foil of the Conclave's way too serious leader, Pierrepont, Vanessa is a magical rebel badass, and this is the first time anything in the normal Dota canon mentions her. So, back to Knock. He was once a proud and arrogant prince of a demon clan. Hope that's what they call guys who rule different planes of hell, by the way. But now he has become a bodyguard, used as a cautionary tale of those in the umbral plane. No, no, not more planes. Please stop with the planes. Umbral. Wait, I've heard this one before. Luna has an umbral rider set, which has absolutely zero lore, but does give her demon horns, because, you know, that shit doesn't need to be explained. And Warlock has the umbral glyph, which states that it would allow him to control not only lesser demons, but also devils. What is a devil? What is the difference between a demon, a devil, and a demon clan? Why does Knock look like he has fur? SD has an umbral set, and that looks fine. An umbral apparently means shadow, so maybe the umbral plane is just like, you know, the dark plane, the shadow plane where hell resides. But no, because Venge also has an umbral set. The blessings of the crested umbra. And she doesn't look like a devil at all. So what is the umbral plane? Why does everything need to be a plane? Back to the comic. So Kanak is a joke. He's a cautionary tale for demons. Don't get too high and mighty. Don't think you're untouchable, or a skinny human lady might summon you and make her your boy toy. Man, demon life is weird. Anyway, On the next page, Quap explains her plan. Kanak was once an ally to Shadow Fiend, Underlord, and her brother, and since he was plucked away, they cut him out of the deal. He can't do anything about it, but if he gives his power to Quap, who is unbound by slavery, she can return to hell. She can take his revenge for him. Note the art here, by the way. On the left, we can see what is a dead ringer for a Disciple of Nevermore, a unit in Artifact that appears to be a unit in Shadowfiend's army. One who can seek out souls to take, but also souls who wish to make deals with the Court of Ristul. Over here, we have what appears to be the first time we've seen a warrior from Underlord's Abyssal Horde. They have the same basic body structure as Underlord. Hey, did you know that Underlord only has 2 feet, but he actually has 4 hands? He walks like a gorilla. That's pretty neat. On the next page, Kanak agrees to give his power and apparently his royal heritage to Quap, which, not sure how that one works. Can one just give being a king away? I guess so. Also, isn't Vanessa, like, standing in this room with them? Why is she just chilling while this is happening? If my enslaved demon bodyguard started giving his soul to an evil succubus, I'd be like, hey, yo, don't do that. Get back there and do the goddamn dishes. Don't give that mysterious evil demon woman your powers. I need you to have powers. Anyway, apparently Vanessa doesn't care, or she wants this to happen, and in the last page, Quap becomes a super demon. We're almost done. Let Nevermore gloat on the soul of his pet bull. Let Vergros plan his assault on Stonehall. Oh, God, we're not almost done. So in Artifact Expansion 1, it is the Battle of Roseleaf. Sorla Khan, the leader of the new Red Mist Horde, post-X, is marching on Stonehall, aka Dota 2's Rome, to burn it down. Legion Commander takes the entire army to cut them off, in a vital choke point known as Roseleaf. Problem is, Roseleaf is occupied. It's the home of the Vool, them little doggos who throw spears of poison from small creep camps. The Legion takes over Roseleaf and conscripts its people, a full, harsh military occupation of the city. One of the boys in her command, a Vool himself, can't take watching his people be subjugated to this overly harsh occupation. He defects, and Rix begins the Vool Rebellion. Now, the Battle of Roseleaf is a shit show. On one side, you have the Vools attacking with guerrilla tactics from the forest and the city, who are aided by Treants, by the way, who always thought the Vools were cool. The Red Mist is pushing on the other side with Sorla Khan at the helm, and the Legion is caught in the middle. Now, we have never found out the result of this battle officially, but there have been many hints. In our last Loregasm, we talked about how confusing and messed up the Dota 2 timeline is, but we know that Underlords takes place after Artifact, because Legion is there, and they talk about stuff that happened in Roseleaf.
I survived Roseleaf. I'll survive here.
Now, in the Dota 2 main canon storyline, Stonefall has already fallen to Underlord. His horde attacks with a dark rift in the center of the city and they massacre it. Legion Commander nearly kills Underlord, but her entire Bronze Legion is dead. Stonehall is gone. So this line, let Underlord plan his assault, puts this arcana post-artifact, potentially post-Underlords, but pre-Dota 2. Except it doesn't, because the Red Mist go to Stonehall. So who takes Stonehall? In one universe's timeline, Stonehall might go down to the Red Mist. We see in the comic, one of the characters finds a book called The Rise and Fall of Stonehall, and it talks about the events happening in Artifact. Yet in Dota, Underlord burns the city. So are we in a different timeline? Well, maybe not, because Shadow Fiend talks about a Vool, which in our standard Dota timeline would mean nothing, but if we're in the Artifact timeline, it must mean it's Rix. In the card art for the Oath, we see a hooded figure speaking to Shadow Fiend. He's making a deal with the Court of Ristul, something in exchange for power. Now we ain't got much to go on, but check out the figure's markings on his coat. Green slashed paint. Now look at Rix. Same markings. And in Artifact 2, which I am still not in, by the way. Oh! It finally fucking happened! Apparently, there is a card called Oathbound Rix. So, Rix took an oath to the court of Ristul. But what was it? And what did it cost him? Well, check out the card description for Relentless Zombie, a Vua who has been returned to life as a Zombo.
The dead are rising in Roseleaf Nog. Someone took the oath.
It appears that we have our answer. Rix gave his soul to the court of Ristul to be the slave of Shadow Fiend, becoming oathbound for power, not only for himself, but to rise the dead from Roseleaf to fight the Legion. And apparently it works. The Legion doesn't seem to win Roseleaf, and this last-ditch deal may have been the deciding factor. Vanessa is clearly concerned about this. She even talks to Nock a full year before this Quap comic came out. So maybe it's not bad writing after all. Maybe she wants to disrupt the court of Ristul. So now we know that this comic is in the artifact altered timeline, the same one Underlords is in, and yet Underlord is still sieging Stonehall, which is in the Dota Prime timeline, the one that Dota 2 is in. So all the timelines are trying to be connected? Maybe, maybe not. Again, Dota 2 is meant to be affected by artifact, which is why Radiant Heroes can play on Dire and Legion Commander can become a demon or stay a human. It's all altered timelines, so who knows? But we do know that this is the first time Dota canon comics refer to any of these altered timelines, so that's pretty neat. And we also know that this Quap Arcana is in the Artifact Underlords alternate universe. So Quap has royal demon powers. She sets forth to ruin her bro, and we are finally done with the comic. Whew! Wow! What a ride. And that's basically it. You're caught up. We good. Now, time for the fun stuff. Potentially the secret shit. It's voice line time. Now, first up, we get some more reinforcement that the narrow maze is owned and operated by the court of Ristul. That's pretty interesting.
You're a cog in a machine. I own the machine.
Quap and Wraith King seem to have some serious issues. Wraith King wants her to be his queen, and Quap wants none of that. We know Wraith King has been alive for so long, he's forgotten his past several times. It says so in his new Skeleton King Arcana. So there's no way that he could have been the original king who summoned her so long ago? Could it be?
I regret that I can no longer feel the true depth of pain. Oh, Queen of Pain, if I had flesh, I'd let you torment it. Ah, Queen of Pain, my bones are yours to crack. Oh, Queen of Pain, I still can't feel your touch. My queen.
My answer is no, Austerian. It will always be no.
And there's no real PC way to say this, but according to the lines, it seems like Quap might be interested in the ladies. There are a lot of innuendos for male characters and references to inflicting pain, but she delivers her lines kind of evilly and like she doesn't care. However, for female characters, the response tones are pretty different.
Stick with me, Rylai. I've got so much to teach you. Forget Night Silver. I could take you places you've never dreamed. We might not have the creature comforts you're accustomed to, Princess, but I assure you a good time.
And it's time now for the big ones. You see, every time that they add an arcana, they add some lines that don't typically get used. At the time of writing, the wiki has not been updated, so I've dug up these lines for Quap and found all these myself. They are all unlabeled. It's called stuff like Ally 103, Rival 104, but found something very, very interesting. Now, all hero voice lines go from 1 to 100 for the standard 117 or whatever heroes in Dota. But in this update, there are some random voice lines hidden within the files marked as 200. And if you put the ally and the rival lines back to back for these random numbers, it really seems like she's talking to new heroes. Let's take a listen. Here is 200 rival and ally.
Listen, If you want to get rich, I've got an idea for you. Care to invent a way out of this one? You've got questionable taste, but I guess that doesn't matter now. Which one are you again? I get confused.
Now to me, this seems like she's talking to some kind of new kinfolk character. There's only one race that has so many that you might get confused on who's who, and only one that seems to invent. But guess what? Wraith King also has some unused lines that match up with this. Check it out.
The simple tools are the best tools, especially when sharpened. Your parts are useless to me.
Parts and tools. Parts are worthless to a king that collects bone. So is it some kind of mechanical thing or some sort of inventor? Maybe it's someone that's not a king, but just similar to looking like another hero. Snapfire also has unused lines that match up to this.
Where's those blueprints? Guess your metal don't match your steel.
So this is really weird. Is it one hero or two? Is one a robot? Listen to these lines.
Ditch that other loser and take a walk on the dead side.
It's so nice to see young love.
Are they in love? Is the new hero in love with a robot? Are they the same thing? I don't know. Let's move on.
Why am I even talking to you? Aren't we precious? Ugh. You know, I didn't realize until just now that you were taking yourself seriously. In my storybooks, all the forest creatures died.
Your tiny carcass was almost a waste of my time.
Now, the Skeleton King line might be for the above inventor hero, but the Quap lines talk about forest creatures who are disgustingly cute and apparently not something Quap even wants to speak to. This seems like the new hero is some kind of very cute, small, mythical forest creature he probably hangs out with enchanters. Is he a unicorn? I literally just typed in small, cute forest creature and saw rabbits, squirrels, whatever the hell this thing is, but SK has a line that might really give us a clue.
Hollow bones? Why, I'd kill you again if you weren't already dead.
Hollow bones. Well, Google tells us that the only creatures with hollow bones are birds. Is the new hero a Skywrath? Eh, maybe, but you know, Skywrath aren't very cute or don't really hang out in forests in the Dota 2 world, so I don't know. If you guys know any hollow-boned, boneless animals that would sing with Snow White if she started yapping, let me know. You might have just discovered the new hero. And last, but certainly not least, the new hero we have the most evidence for. This guy. Listen in.
No thank you. Who doesn't like a little bit of control? Mindless is useless in my book.
Mind control. Mindlessness. And someone Quap would rather not let him use his powers on her. Now, this reminds me of something. Way back in the Mars update, we had a ton of unused voice lines in Mars's update too, and guess what? They fit right in.
You should have made me kill myself, because that was your only chance! Not even the fates control me! There is something seriously wrong! No one controls a god while I'm around! Get out of my head!
Now, back in the day, these seemingly came out of nowhere, and there's also a lot of lines of Mars barking like a dog. Look, I don't know what's going on with Mars's unused lines, but this is nuts. With Quap and Mars, this is the best evidence we have for a new hero in Dota 2. Skeleton King doesn't really have any lines that talk about mind control, which is odd, but two heroes talk about mind control, and this sent me back to Snapfire, who also has two mind control lines.
That's for taking advantage of Mortimer. Well, now I got a scapegoat.
A scapegoat for her actions because they weren't her own. She was being controlled and someone taking over Mortimer. So what does this all mean? Who is this new hero? Well, guess what? I can tell you. Because I invented it.
This is the coup de grace, ladies and gentlemen. Parasite's ultimate is a single target spell. And it's called, very, very fittingly, Parasitic Invasion. And when cast, Parasite leaps inside of an enemy hero and takes over their body for the duration.
That's right, baby. Parasite, the mind control hero. I made this garbage in 2017 for the Community Hero Project. Sunspan deleted it because he said the idea was stupid. Well, who's stupid now, Sunspan? Anyway, that will do it for the Quap Arcana, and pretty much the Skeleton King Arcana as well. We have a few mysteries left. What is the importance of SK's sundial? What is the globe on Vanessa's desk, and why is it on this floating paper? But I'm sure we will get more clues on this and future hidden heroes in the next Arcanas that are coming. Oh, no, 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 no! Thanks for watching. And thank you, of course, to our big boy Patreons who keep this show rolling. You guys know who you are, you sweet little devils, and I love you so. Thank you for donating your time and your money and your ideas to the Loregasms. We will be back when we get some new Arcanas and Personas coming out, as I'm sure there will be even more to the lore.